trick. Amen. Well, good evening, everybody. Good evening. Welcome to the house of our God. Glad you come out on a Wednesday night. It's good to see y'all. We do want to welcome, if some of you have noticed, Quinn is a new member to our greeter and usher team. So, Brother Quinn, we welcome you in the name of the Lord. Welcome to the team. Welcome to the team. And those of you who have not been here for a while, I know Michelle was here. We welcome Michelle back home safely. Brother Cecil, it's good to have you out on a Wednesday night Bible study. Praise the Lord. And all of you. Dominic, it was a pleasure to meet you today. Glad you're here, brother. God bless you. And all of you that are in the house. You know, we are in the series here, The Good Father. And with this series here, we are studying the liturgical year. And I think it's a great study. I'm enjoying it. If nothing else, we learn of all the feasts and celebrations that are actually in our calendar. So we might resume an actual feast maybe next Wednesday or the following Wednesday. But right now, we're going to study to see how the words of God have affected us and how the words of God are changing our lives in a practical way. We're going to talk about that tonight. And Pastor Edward, it's always good to have you in the house. It's always a joy to worship God with you, Pastor Edward. You have such a heart for God, such a love for God. It's just good to have you in the house. You're a blessing. Always a blessing, brother. Always a blessing. May God continue to bless your ministry in a great way. So we are in the series with the feast. But if you look at your paper, we're studying through the year to see how these feasts are changing our lives. And the subtitle tonight is God's Simplicity. It's really an interesting topic. It's one that I enjoy. God's Simplicity. As powerful as God is, as mysterious as he may seem to be, as complex as he may seem to be, as unsearchable truly as he is, it's always beautiful to see the simplicity of God. Amen. God is so simple. God is so easy. So why don't we start with our passage this evening? We are in the Gospel of Matthew, the 11th chapter, and we're going to read verses 25 through 30 and launch from there. So Pastor Dad, if you wouldn't mind, why don't you start us with the reading?
At that time, Jesus said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and received and believed them, revealed them, rather, to the children. Yes, Father, this was your good pleasure.
All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest.
Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle, humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light."
Yeah, that's good. I think we have read this verse last Wednesday. Maybe we even read it again on Sunday. I'm not too sure. But even the comforting words there at the end where Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." Amen. The word of the Lord. You know, right there in verses 25 and 26, let's start with that. It says, Jesus prayed this prayer in the TLB. "Oh, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, thank you for hiding the truth from those who think themselves so wise." That's good. It's a good wording there. And for revealing it to the little children. "Yes, Father, for it pleased you to do it this way." It is God's good pleasure to reveal the mysteries of heaven and earth, the mysteries of the kingdom, to the simple. You know, this is very comforting words because it says that God and all the things of God is not just for a few chosen. It's not just for the elite. It's not just for the wise. Or it's not just for the preachers or the priests or those who are involved in ministry in some way. My goodness, he is the God of all creation. He is available to all of his creation, no matter what place on earth or what position in life you hold. God doesn't choose to reveal himself to anyone more than another person. He wants to reveal himself to the whole world. And in this passage here, Jesus was praying to his Father, and he thanked his Father that it pleased his Father to reveal the mysteries to the simple. To the simple. And you know, as we've always said in this house, you know, God is not hard. God is not hard to find. You know, you don't have to be an Einstein to figure out God. As a matter of fact, God really wants to show himself in a simple way to all of humanity. And as Jesus walked the earth, he always chose the simple things in life to demonstrate the kingdom of heaven. You know, he always chose the simple trades in life. He chose to reveal himself through fishermen and through farmers and through birds and through fields and through trees. Because everybody knows about fields and trees. Not everybody has the book knowledge, but everybody knows about the sky. Everybody knows about birds. Everybody knows about fish. So he said, let me show you God. Let me show you heaven in the simplest ways, right? Amen. Man, God's not looking to hide himself from us. He's looking to reveal himself to us. Amen. God is not hard. Yes. Anytime we make God hard, it's not the plan of the Father. And here in verse 25, it says that he chose to hide the truth from those who think themselves to be wise. I think it was on a Friday night Bible study that we spoke of, and I know your lady spoke on it also, that Paul prayed that the church would know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge. He wanted them to know a love that is beyond knowledge. You know, you can't find God necessarily from reading a book. You know, you really have to experience him. You know, you really have to have a one-on-one relationship with the Almighty God to get to know him. You can read all of the books and you can have all of the studying and learning you want, but if you don't talk to him, you know? Amen. You ever get so wrapped up in your studies that you just forget just to talk to him? I don't know about any of you guys, but you know, have you ever been reading the Bible diligently, trying to get anybody to, like, I don't know, does anybody try to get their reading time in at times, you know? Like, I just got to get my reading time in. I'm almost done. I have to read one chapter a day. I got to pray for 5 or 10 minutes. I'll get to you in a second. You know, sometimes we don't want the phone to ring or the bell to ring or whatever. I'm getting my time in. Sometimes for me, I don't even want God talking to me. God starts to talk to me. He's like, not now. I'm getting my reading time in. I am very serious. I cannot tell you how many times I've been reading the Bible and God's talking to me. He's like, just 1 second, Lord. I just got to get this. Does anybody or am I the only guy? Anybody? It's like, hold that, Lord, hold that, Lord, hold that, Lord. Because I know if I read this, I'll be able to understand you better. I just need this. That's crazy. It's just, but I've done that so many times. Like, you know, the Lord's like, what? God's easy. It's not hard to find God. It's not hard to find the kingdom of heaven. God says it's his good pleasure to show it to the simple. You see, the only way you will ever know God or heaven or anything is if God chooses to reveal it to you. You can't get it without him.
That's
right. Unless God opens up the kingdom to you, I don't care how many verses in the Bible you read that day, you cannot get it unless God reveals it to you. You don't get it through academics. You don't get it through reading the Bible. I don't care if it's not. We're not against reading the Bible. You know that.
Yes.
But it's not about, you know, getting in and memorizing it. It's only opened up to you when he reveals it to you. When he shows it to you, the kingdom of heaven is simple. You know, and he reveals it in the simplest ways. And if we had our eyes and ears open, we would see that God reveals himself to us through people, all kinds of people, all day long, right? But it's his pleasure to give the kingdom in a simple way. It's his pleasure to give it in an easy way. And, you know, whatever academics you do, that, you know, God bless you for that, but that's not how we get a revelation. A revelation is a gift. And, you know, maybe we can read a line or two underneath that passage. It says, the creator of the world, heaven and earth, reveals his unfathomable mystery, but not to those who invest their reason in searching for it, but to the simple. The Father also simply and freely gives all of his knowledge away. And even in that passage there, it says that all things have been given to me by my Father. God wants to disclose himself to you and I. He wants to show himself to you and I. And it's usually through the all-day, everyday things in life. You know, how many times have you guys prepared for, like, reading or praying? You know, like I can't tell you how many times I was getting ready to go do some reading or praying, and like, God is talking to me before I get to my prayer time. And it's like, you know, I'm like, hold off, Lord. I'm not in my position yet. I got to get to my position. God wants to talk to you all day. He wants to be a part of your life all day, every day. And he wants to show you his goodness all day, every day, in the very simple things of life. You know, God is about our daily lives. So many times we think that our daily lives is without God. You know, like, I just got to get through the day. You know, any of you ever feel like that? I just got to get through this day. I just got to get these things done, as if God is outside of that, you know? And then once I get these things done, then I'll get involved in kingdom stuff. And God is trying to retrain us to show us that kingdom stuff is every day, all day stuff, man. Mm-hmm. It's not about going to church on Sunday or Wednesday, and you know I'm not talking about that. He's saying, I want to be involved with you all day, every day. Sometimes we're involved with conflict and situations, and we think that we just got to get through this conflict, and then, I'll find peace with God. But God, like, causes conflict to come into your life. Anybody believe that?
Yes.
He causes the conflict, you know, because he wants to reveal himself to us in all the things of life. God is in every moment of every day revealing himself to us. And we all need to be reminded of that on a regular basis, because we forget. We think we just got to get through this before we can get to God. All right, let's move on a little bit here. In Roman numeral number 2, it's interesting. It says the Son makes known the Father. Somebody read to us again Matthew 11:27. Somebody who hasn't read Matthew 11:27.
All things have been committed to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father. And no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him.
Anybody ever read that passage or meditate on that for a moment? You know, it says here that no one knows the Father but the Son, and no one knows the Son but the Father, and no one knows the Father except to whom the Son chooses to reveal him to. And right there underneath it says, we must seek the Father in the Son and only in him. The only way we will ever get to know God is through Christ. You can't get to know God outside of Christ. The only way to know the Father is through the Son. Okay? Amen. Truly. Now, there is only one God in this world, and I know, you know, the world serves or pursues different things and perhaps even different gods. We only have one God. We only have one Father, believe it or not. But the only really way to get to know the true God is through the Son. You can only really get to know God through the Son, Jesus Christ, yes, but he's just the first Son. There's many sons born after him. Do you know that? Do you know there's other sons? Because Jesus says, now he started out as the only begotten Son, but then he became the first begotten Son because he produced many brothers and sisters. So the only way to get to know the Father now is through the Son or through one of his sons and daughters. You will get to know God through mankind. He chose it. How do you get to know an invisible God? Sometimes through a visible God, Jesus Christ. You will get to know the invisible God through the visible God. This scripture says here, the only way you will know the Father, you can only get to know God through the Son. It's the only way to know God. It's through the Son. You got to know him through the Son. And then my questions I put there after that is, why go through the Son for all the mysteries of heaven? Why do that? Why do we have to go through the Son? Why don't we just go directly to the Father? Why do we have to go through the Son? I don't know. What are you asking me for? But it says you got to go through the Son because there's divine mysteries here. And so many times we think that we can, and just as we reflect, so many times we think that we can disassociate ourselves from everybody around us because we're tired of everybody around us, and I'm just going to go talk to God. Me and God are right. The rest of the world don't matter. That's wrong thinking. But how many times have you thought that? Just me and God. The whole world, they're wrong, they're crazy, they're idiots, they're morons. I really don't like them right now. Just me and you, Lord. Me and you. Me and you are right. That's all that matters. It's impossible. It's impossible for you and God to be right when you're not right with the whole world. It's impossible because you can only know the Father through the Son. See, God created it this way because he wants us, first of all, to see God through Jesus Christ. But then he also wants us to see God through each other. He wants us to see each other. To see each other. Scripture says, those of you who say that you love God and hate your brother, you're a liar. How can you love God who you cannot see and hate your brother who you can see? How about that? I don't know if I like that. But Scripture says that. But how many times in our thinking do we think it's legitimate thinking to say, I love God, I just can't stand you? Thank you, Pastor. Right? Me and God, I love God. With all my heart, I love God. And sometimes we're not even that kind. I have heard out of the mouths of Christians say, but I hate, usually it's towards a family member, but I hate you. But I hate you. And if it's not words, it's with actions. But I hate you. I will not forgive you. I will not be kind to you. How can you say you love God who you cannot see and love your brother who you can see? You're a liar. You're a liar. It's impossible. It's impossible. And that's why God is saying there's only one way to know the Father. It's through the Son. You must learn to love each other and get along and appreciate and see God in humanity. God is causing us to get our eyes off of this invisible realm and causing us also to be involved in the visible realm, to see God in the visible place, to see God in each other, to see God in mankind. God wants us to see him in each other. I know it all originates in Jesus Christ. There's no way out of that. He is the firstborn. He is the Son of God. I'm not erasing that. You will only know God through the Son, but we are also sons. Jesus left the earth. He left you here. Why? I have no idea. But he left the earth and left you in his place. Crazy. But you are the body of Christ. You are now the body of Christ upon the earth. And the only way that I can know God is through you. But can I go just directly to him? Nope. I cannot discard you and go directly to my God. He's going to say, you're going to come and give me a gift? He says, leave your gift at the altar and go make it right with your brother. Then come back to me with your gift. Right. Does anybody know? Does anybody know Scripture, right? Mm-hmm. God is constantly causing us to be involved with each other, to love each other, to care for one another. The Father in heaven doesn't want you to have direct access to him as if you just go to God, everything's all right and everybody around you don't matter. It's like a parent who has a child and the children constantly vying for the parent's attention, and all the parent wants to do is for the children to get along. Or any organization or community. It's not just about the leader, it's about the community getting along with each other. What the Father wants to do is have you stop coming to him and say, just can't you all just get along? Instead of everybody going to the Father saying, this person stinks, this person's going to hell, this person is my enemy, God, go get them. God the Father is like, really? Really? And he says, can't you all just get along? And he says, no, you don't have direct access to me. You must go through the Son. Jesus Christ, yes. Of course, Jesus Christ. But you can't just have direct access to the Father. You must get along with each other. You must take care of each other. You must be kind to each other. You must forgive each other. Scripture even says, if you don't forgive someone else, I won't forgive you. Why do you think these scriptures are here? It's not for the offense. It's for the revelation that you must love each other. To say that you love God and hate everybody, it's not true. To say that you and God are all right, but the rest of the world stinks, there's no truth in that, right? When you can't get along with people around you, listen, I know, and anybody knows, your relationship with the Father, it's a picture of your relationship with each other. You know, you think you and God are fine. I know you and God are not fine just by how we talk about each other, how we handle each other, how we love each other, how we're kind to each other. Well, but me and God are fine. No, you're not. It's a mirror image. How you relate with humanity is a mirror image of your relationship with the Father.
Yes, amen.
There's only one way to know the Father. It's through the Son. It's through the Son. See, God created it this way. Jesus came to the earth. So even with these questions, why go through the Son for all the mysteries of heaven? Because if we could discard the Son, we would. If we could discard each other at times, we would. If we could discard all of the mysteries and treasures of heaven that are all around us, we would. Because we don't see the treasures and the mysteries of God that is all around us. And even in Hebrews, we had that series, and I think it's so great, and I think this is what God is telling us again. It says the greatest revelation of God will always be through the Son. The greatest revelation of God will not be found in this book. This is a great book, and you can get the revelation, but the greatest revelation of God is not in this book. So you can quote it, and you can read it all day, every day, but that's not the greatest revelation. The greatest revelation of God is through the Son. The Son is the greatest revelation of the Father. So you can read this all day, every day, and discard your the people all around you, and you still don't know know God. I know you can quote that real good, but you don't know God.
Amen to that.
All right, Bill. Because the greatest revelation of the Father is seen through the Son. That's what Hebrews says. He is the greatest. He is the image of the invisible. And even God took on the form of flesh to show you, and you know, we've talked about this for so long, but God wants us to see the beauty and the salvation that he has provided in each other. Your salvation will come through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, his body still remains upon the earth. It's you. My salvation is found in you. It's found in you. It's found in you. Does anybody want to give me a witness?
Yes, amen.
You see, God's going to help us, but God uses people to help us, you know. When God sends me a blessing, it doesn't fall out of the sky. I've told you how many times. It usually comes through a person.
Yes, yes.
My blessings don't come from the sky.
Yes, amen.
Not to this day. They have not come from the sky. I have not looked up in my bedroom, and nothing has fell from my ceiling. Not dollars, not anything in particular. But and even my love, I don't find my love in an empty room. Some of you, you find your love in each other. You find your salvation in each other. It's designed by the Father. The only way you're going to get to know God is through each other.
Amen.
You can get on your knees and hide yourself in a closet all day long. You don't know God unless you know people. If you don't know people, you don't know God. Does anybody want to say amen to that?
Amen.
If you don't know people, you don't know God.
Amen.
Yeah. And I think that's really, you know, the focal point of tonight. I want us to see this. I want us to see this. So you know, it says there, did we read Matthew 11:27? We did. It says, we must seek the Father in the Son and in him only. So if you turn your page with me.
Good.
Why don't somebody read who has not read Colossians 2, verses 2 through 3.
This is what I have asked of God for you, that you will be encouraged and knit together by strong ties of love, and that you will have the rich experience of knowing Christ with real certainty and clear understanding. For God's secret plan, now at last made known, is Christ himself. In him lie hidden all the mighty untapped treasures of wisdom and knowledge.
Beautiful. And this is like one of our ministry verses, you know, that God would tie our hearts together, knit together our hearts with strong ties of love. Notice that our relationship with Christ and all of the mysteries are associated with our hearts being knit together with strong ties of love. It says that right there, right? That you will all be encouraged and knit together with strong ties of love. God wants to knit our hearts together with strong ties of love. Everyone. He wants to knit our hearts together. Then we will know the rich experience of knowing Christ. How will we know the rich experience of Christ and all the mysteries and all the treasures? By me loving you, by me knowing you. By me being involved in your life, I know God. That's what Scripture tells us. All of the mysteries of heaven, all of the treasures of heaven, we want the treasures of heaven. They're hidden in everybody around you. Everybody around you is a treasure chest. Everybody. Everybody you come to church with, everybody you go to school with, everybody you go to work with, every person you walk by on the street, they are a treasure chest. They are the mysteries of heaven that are hidden. And sometimes I don't know it and you don't know it. We walk by them all day long.
Amen.
Talking to the Father. I think that's why God chose to reveal himself through the Son, and no one knows the Father except through the Son. The only way to know God in heaven is through his Son, Jesus Christ, and the ongoing sons and daughters through each other.
Amen.
All of the treasures of heaven. God took all of the treasures of heaven. You know, you wonder about the treasures of heaven, and we all talk about going to heaven someday, and in heaven there's all kinds of beautiful things, right? Sure. You know, we got life, and we got joy, and we got peace. We got streets of gold. I don't know. You might have a mansion. You might have a big barrel of gold in heaven. And God says all of the treasures of heaven are in Christ, in you, in you. All of the treasures of heaven are in everybody all around us.
Amen.
Those are the treasures.
Yes, amen.
Hidden, in plain view, that is. Hidden. We walk by them all day long, but they're hidden because we just don't see them. I know God is teaching us this. I know he is. He's changing the way we think, and it's okay. God will reveal himself through the dispensations of time. As time progresses, he will dispense himself a little bit more, so we know him a little bit bigger, I know him a little bit larger, and usually what we discover is God is bigger than we thought. Anybody? Come on now. He's more loving than we thought. He's more forgiving than we thought. He saved more of the world than we thought. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and he's causing us to come outside of this invisible, unreal realm, if you will, just me and God, and one day I'm going to heaven, and the rest of the world can burn in hell. I don't care. Oh, I do care, but I'm still going to heaven. And he's changing our minds. He's changing our minds, where we start to love each other and care for one another and protect each other. Who? All of humanity. The greatest creation of God is mankind. He put all of his treasures inside of all of mankind. Not if you have a certain name, not if you go to a certain church, not if you belong to a certain country or a certain race. Every tribe, every tongue. See, what do you find in heaven? Scripture says that heaven has every tribe, every nation, every tongue, all of them in heaven. Where's heaven? Mm-hmm. It's all around you. You just don't know it. Amen. God is in every tribe, every language, every nation, everybody. All of the treasures of heaven are hidden inside Christ, in humanity. There's only one way to know the Father, is to know each other. Maybe that'll help us. Maybe that'll help us. Maybe that'll help us. Maybe that'll help us love people. Maybe that'll help us care for people. Maybe that'll help us want to know people, because we're all too busy in life to get to know. I have no room. Anybody like that? Like, I got no room to know one more person. Like, I really don't want to know you. And I know you think like that. I know you think like that. Because I think like that at times. It's like, I got enough people. I don't need to know anybody else. Believe me. I'm busy enough. I cannot get involved with your life. Let somebody else. I don't care what your name is. I don't care where you're from. I just want to go home. Okay. Somebody read 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 through 13.
And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life.
This is really interesting. Eternal life is also found in our interactions with each other. When we know the Son, we have life. Now, you know, you experience these truths. It's just that we don't put them into words or don't think about it. You experience these truths. How many times have you been with someone and they like spark new life inside of you? Anybody?
Yes, amen.
How many times? And I could be sitting here on a Wednesday and just hear Pastor Edward sing, and that sparks life in me. It sparks life in me. Yes. Simple. God is simple, yeah, but powerful. How many times has someone just shook your hand or said good morning to you or said a word to you and it took you out of yourself, if you will?
Yeah.
See, no one knows life outside of the Son. That's the Son of God. That's Christ. That's the inner essence of whoever human being is. God causes us to be life givers and light givers and everything else. Our salvation is all around us. It's all around us. It's found in every woman, every man, every child. Salvation is all around us. There's no disclaimers on this. There's no set category or group of people who can do this. It's all of mankind who has this inside of them. All of mankind. We are made in the image and likeness of God. God says that. I don't know what people are saying, but God says that man is made in the image and likeness of God. We have the breath of God breathed in us. Otherwise, we would not be alive. You know, we say this all the time. Don't tell me it takes a Christian to breathe life into you, because you know if you were to call somebody a Christian or a non-Christian, I have had someone who we would call, quote unquote, a non-Christian still give me life, still give me treasure, still give me joy, still give me love. So don't tell me any of this religious garbage about you got to be a Christian to be able to do this. You just got to be a human being to be able to do this. Don't tell me that. Any human being can give another human being life. It happens all day, every day. Human beings produce other human beings without even calling upon the name of Jesus. They might not call upon the name of Jesus, but Jesus sure has called their name.
Amen.
Jesus sure has given them life. Life does not come into the world outside of God. He is the giver of life.
Amen.
And it goes on all day throughout humanity because it's God. God. I want God to broaden our understandings where we see God in all of humanity. We see good in all of humanity. We see love and the treasures of the kingdom in all of humanity. Not to pass by anybody in the street, not to discard or have disdain for everyone, because no one will know the Father except through the Son. And anyone who says, I hate my brother and loves God is a liar. It's impossible. If you can see somebody, you got to love somebody, and you got to let them love you. They are filled with all the treasures of heaven. Right now,
yeah.
This is the word of the Lord. So let's read on a little bit. I found John interesting. John chapter 6, somebody read 51 and 53.
I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Then Jesus said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you.
Okay, that's interesting. You see, God or spirit cannot say this because spirit doesn't have flesh. So the father outside of the Son cannot say this. The Father had to produce a Son made in flesh to say this. So even here we see that flesh is, there's nothing wrong with flesh in that regard. The only evils of flesh that Scripture speaks of is a natural way of thinking. It's not the actual human race that is evil. It is a natural way of thinking outside of God that God condemns, not humanity. And we confuse the two. Sometimes we think humanity is cursed. Humanity is not cursed. Jesus took the curse away, whatever curse there may have been. Jesus said, mission accomplished. There's no more curse left on the earth. I don't know what you see. But Jesus took away the curse. He nailed it to the cross. I don't know what you see. When Jesus came out of the tomb, there's no more curse on the earth. I don't know what you see. But Jesus doesn't see the curse. Can I get a witness from one person, two people, three people? He paid the price. I don't know. Should he go back and do it again? So he did the job. Yeah, sure he did. Of course he did. You know he did. Yeah, sure. I'm just playing with you. So you see, Jesus says, eat of my flesh. And he says, if you don't eat of my flesh, you have no life inside of you. Unless you eat of my flesh, you have no life. God is telling us, he's compelling us, we must partake of one another. Yes. You do not have life. As a matter of fact, eternal life is not found outside of partaking of flesh. And but Scripture says, flesh and blood shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven. Well, Jesus Christ had flesh and he did inherit the kingdom of heaven. So it's talking about a way of thinking. It's not talking about this. It's not talking about humanity. Jesus had flesh and he had bones. His disciples touched it. He said, do I not have flesh? Do I not have bones? Yet he ascended into heaven. So there is a flesh that does go to heaven and there's a flesh that doesn't go to heaven. I don't know what you're talking about, preacher. But you see, humanity is not evil, and these bodies are not evil. The only way to have eternal life is through these bodies and through a humanity. The only way to have eternal life is partaking of flesh. Doesn't Scripture say that? You cannot have heaven or the Father or eternal life unless you partake of flesh. Unless you partake of flesh. Holy flesh, God flesh, sure. But that now that's found in you and I, because are you the body of Christ? Or are these just words that we say that have no meaning? So then we must partake of each other. The only way I will have life is if I partake of you. I can ignore you and hate you, then I don't have life. Now, I know you've felt that sometimes. I know you've lived those lives. I know you've lived lives where you've been angry and bitter at people and it's taken the life from you. Anybody want to be honest?
Yes.
And the only way life has been restored to me is by embracing you and loving you and partaking of life with you. When I partake of life with you, I now have life.
Amen.
Eternal life. Which is not necessarily length of days, but quality of them,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. See, the only way you and I can experience eternity in heaven and God is through flesh. If you don't partake of flesh, you don't have the kingdom. Isn't that what it says? But I want us to look at that and try to get a greater understanding, or not a greater understanding, just a today understanding, what God is telling us. God is telling us that he dwells in us. He is telling us that we are all one. He is telling us to love each other and experience eternity through the relationships that we enjoy with one another. Experience the good life through all of the treasures of heaven that are around us. Does anybody
yes.
want to say amen to that? And he said, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood. So that's why the Father will reveal himself through the Son. He says you must partake of humanity. We're so quick to curse humanity and this world, and wait for God to blow it up because one day we're going to heaven, because we don't see eternity in heaven that is inside of all of us. We don't see the world that God is blowing up. It's not a physical world, but it's the world between our ears. It's the way you think. That's what God is blowing up. It's the elements of this world that he's destroying. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
And it's not like yesterday was wrong. Yesterday was just stepping stones to get to today. You know, yesterday wasn't wrong. What about everything we thought yesterday? It brought us to today. Mm-hmm. You know, God's got to build line upon line. He can't give you these great truths without 10 steps prior to it, because you'll never accept the great revelation without these little progressions to get there.
Yes, amen.
You know? And I think more and more God is trying to show us of a beauty that he created so long ago. And you see, the objective of God, everybody, listen, the objective of God is not to have a separation between heaven and earth, that one day you will leave earth and go to heaven. That is not God. It's not Bible. It's nothing. It's erroneous. You see, the true heaven and earth is one that is combined. The new creation is a heaven and earth that's combined. And even as Jesus preached his whole life, he said, let heaven come on earth, not even for you to go to heaven. He never preached for you to go to heaven. He said, may heaven come on earth. Pray that heaven come on earth. He didn't say pray that you go to heaven. Jesus never said pray that you go to heaven. But what do? We pray that you go to heaven. But that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said pray that heaven come to you.
Amen.
There isn't a separation between heaven and earth. And even what Pastor Phil said on Sunday, I think God is erasing the dividing line or the veil of flesh or whatever separates heaven and earth. Heaven and earth were never meant to be separated. He says the two are one. Heaven on earth is always the plan of God. The new creation is heaven coming down upon earth. And we have always created this separation. You know, one day I'm going to leave this earth and go to heaven, as if that's the plan of God. You will live this life on earth, and one day you will go to heaven. No, that's not Bible. It's not God. The plan is always, thy kingdom come. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And if you want to cheat and go to the end of the book, which is Revelation, you'll see in the end of the book, once again, the new Jerusalem comes down out of heaven and lands here upon earth.
Right.
You ain't going anywhere. And if you think you're going somewhere, it's only so you can come right back down here again anyway. And all of those who have died and gone before us, listen, they ain't so far from us. Just when Jesus would say, listen, the kingdom of heaven, it ain't so far from you. If all your loved ones are in heaven, Jesus says heaven itself, it's not so far from you. Jesus says, heaven is closer than your hands and feet. So what does that mean? That means I got my aunt over here, I got my uncle over here, I got my mother over here. They're all around me. We are surrounded by them. If heaven is closer than my hands and my feet, and my loved ones are in heaven, then they're all around me, perhaps even in me, perhaps everywhere. And the only thing that separates heaven and earth, or visible and invisible, is a certain, you know, veil upon our minds and eyes and thinking and seeing. That's why. But God is beginning to change the way we think. Anybody out there?
Amen. Yes.
Sure, sure. So even let's end. Okay. So we come to the final Roman numeral. Come to me, all. Somebody read for us again, Matthew 11:27. Excellent. Good reading there, Quinn. Good reading. Now, that seems to contradict the come to me all. You know, sometimes it says no one knows the Son or no one knows the Father except to whom the Son chooses to reveal. Well, it says come to me all. God wants to reveal, or Jesus wants to reveal himself, and God wants to reveal himself to all, not to a few. He says come to me how many?
All.
Come to me all. All who? All who are weary and heavy laden. Any honest person who lives and breathes will say, I am weary and heavy laden. And he says, come to me all. So this isn't a matter of selection here. This is a matter of, once again, you know, what does it say? Many are called, but few are chosen. Broad is the way that leads to destruction, and narrow is the way. And we think this is always a matter of God disowning people. No, it isn't. He's not disowning people. He's disowning ideas and thinking and logics. Not people. Not people. Not people. When God says the wicked will be destroyed, but the righteous will be saved, the wicked and the righteous dwell inside of us all. The wicked isn't like one person is not the embodiment of wickedness, and contrary to what some of us might think. We think the wicked are certain people in life. Really? Well, I fit into that category sometimes. And you say, I know, preacher. I know.
I didn't say it.
But you thought it. According to wicked, you know, being defined in the Bible, sometimes I fall into that category because he says the fearful and the unbelieving and the proud. Well, if you want the confessions of a preacher, sometimes that's me. So am I the wicked or the righteous? Am I going to heaven or hell? Am I going to be destroyed or saved? The answer is yes, 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 yes. Because all of the wicked that dwells in me and all of the wicked that dwells in you will be destroyed. And the only one that shall remain is the righteous.
Yes.
For the just and the righteous shall inherit the earth. You will inherit this earth. The wickedness inside you will not be the one that prevails, will not inherit the earth. The Christ inside of you will inherit. You will possess your possessions, which is your soul. Right? So this few and this chosen is only one. There's only one. But in him, there's only one, right? There's only one God, one Father. There's only one body. There's only one. Yeah, so it's very narrow, one. But we all are the one. All right? So let's see. We'll just read a couple of sentences there at the end. It says, we can see why the Father. We're going to change tones now. I did want to talk about seeing us as the body of Christ, but here at the end. We can see why the Father reveals his mystery only to the simple. Since this mystery is his own simple, unforced, perfect, and total self-giving to the Son. He only reveals himself to the simple because God is simple. God's not hard. God is not hard. There's nothing hard about knowing him. There's nothing hard about loving him. Can I get a witness from one person?
Amen. Yes, amen.
So then I'm going to say, if you said amen to that, then the extension is also true. There's nothing hard about loving each other.
Amen.
There's nothing hard about living with each other. There's nothing hard about getting along with each other. Okay, the amens decreased, but they were still there. But they were still there. I'm going to take note of that. All right, let's see. The God of the simple is really the Lord of heaven and earth, as Jesus addressed him, the Almighty and the All-Wise. But his almighty power is not the kind that overpowers and oppresses the weak, right? Anybody here?
Amen.
His omniscience is not the kind that despises and abandons the simple, right? Let's follow up with this. Are you anxious to get to that last sentence? That means nothing if I keep talking. Nothing is more powerful than God's humility. Nothing is wiser and more understanding than his divine simplicity.
Amen.
Amen. You know, some of the mysteries of God are right down here. It's very simple. Humility, lowliness. And I think as God humbles us and causes us to become lowly, I think we'll love a little bit more. I really do.
Yes.
I think it's pride and arrogance that keeps us from being so kind and loving. So with that, I'm going to ask you all to stand up, and if I could have a willing volunteer to close us with a word of prayer, please.
Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for the words of Pastor Michael, Lord, that spoke from the heart of you, my God. We ask you, Lord, to continue to give us the guidance and the patience that we need, my Lord, so we can love one another.
Amen.
We can care about one another.
Amen.
We can put one another in front of us.
Yes, Lord.
We ask, Lord, that you continue to give us the knowledge and the understanding that it takes, my Lord, it takes to stay in and the faith and the belief in you, my God. From the very beginning of time, my Lord, you touched our lives.
Thank you, Lord.
Most of the time, we never even knew it. So because of the light that you've lit in our hearts, my Lord, that shines across this land, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for the sacrifice you made, my God.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Without that sacrifice, we wouldn't exist. I ask the Lord to put a blessing upon this church.
Yes, Lord.
All these people that are standing in front of this great God of ours.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
May I stay upon you, my Lord.
Yes, Lord.
May my heart stay true and faithful to you, my Lord. May the light and the love that burns inside of me, may it be contagious and be caught by everyone, my God. I ask this in the powerful, precious name of Jesus. And God's house says, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Bill. Very nice. Thank you for that.